Alrighty, so let's begin. Sorry, you're not going to have pretty slides, I apologise. I did do some pretty slides. I did them late, and including while I was on the plane this afternoon, so which is part of why you don't have the pretty slides, because if I'd done them earlier, then you'd have them already. It's also, I just want to say also at the beginning, so it's nearly 9 o'clock, which is late for you guys to be listening to a talk. It's obviously nearly 10 o'clock my time, and on a Friday night, I'm totally in bed by now. So, as I once very unwisely said to some friends of mine, I'm going to be having a really good time to be up after 10. And they now look at, I'll be over for dinner, and they kind of, it gets close to 10 o'clock, and they're like, you having a good time? You enjoying yourself? I'm excited to tell you. So I'm really delighted to be with you. Tonight we're going to be talking about kind of a little bit of big picture stuff. You're going to drill down into something of your story as Emmanuel tomorrow. So my job tonight is to try and put that story in a bit of context. And obviously part of that context, and I'm sure you've already talked about that this year as a community, part of that context is 50 years of Charismatic Renewal. So it's 50 years since the famous Duquesne weekend. In fact, the actual anniversary was a couple of weeks ago. It was just at the end of February, a week ago, really. So two parts to the talk, really. Charismatic Renewal, and then also about communities like Emmanuel. So I wanted to start with a line from Alastair McIntyre, who's a philosopher, and he has a great line where he says, "I can only tell you who I am if I can tell you the stories I'm part of. I can only tell you who I am if I can tell you the stories that I'm part of." So tonight I'm going to try and offer you a particular kind of story. It's actually a bit of theology, really. Theology is really a kind of story. It's really a way of telling a story about God and about who we are as the church. So it might not sound like a story at times, but it really is a story, with the aim of being able to say at the end of that, well, here's something about who we are, because I think that's obviously very critical if we want to think then about where do we go, what do we do. So one of the key things about that, I think, is that there's the scriptural principle too, isn't it, that it's from our identity that our mission comes from. Okay, so when Saul has that experience on the Damascus Road, we usually call that the conversion of Paul, and that's kind of partly the truth. But the key part of that is he gets given a job. He gets given something to do. And so that's true for us, and so that's why it's important, I think, that we reflect upon it. I wanted to say just too, I said I'm going to talk a little bit of theology. I'm not sure how many old school charismatics are in the room. There's probably a few of us. Old school charismatics don't always like theology that much. Let's just stick to praising Jesus and trusting in the Spirit. And we simply say that, I just want to say just simply in that God gave us minds as well, and he expects us to use them. Now, having said that, I also think that it's really important that the kind of theology we do is, the expression from one of my favorite theologians is that it's a kneeling theology. Begins in prayer, and hopefully should actually take us to prayer too, to the worship of God. So that's part of what I want to try and do tonight as well. A bit of an exercise in kneeling theology. The last kind of introductory thing that I wanted to say, no, second last. Second last introductory thing I want to say is Emma explained something of where how far we go back as next door neighbor, almost next door neighbors. Those of you who were at Emma and Luke's wedding, in the booklet she put, for years now I've been telling everybody that I'm Chris's second sister. So I only have one sister, but Emma, because we're both Ryans, Emma's maiden name's Ryan, just like mine, she convinced many people that we were brother and sister.
It's their fault, they assumed.
I'm kind of scarred by that, but I'm distracted. What I wanted to say was, much more seriously, is I guess I come very much as a visitor tonight, but in another sense too, like I go back a long way with Emma, but I go back with many of you quite a way too. I remember it was a very newly ordained priest, I think, when people like Beth and Teresa and a bunch of others, Renee Doyle, came on summer, on our summer school. So back in just around 2002, something like that, I think. They were kids and I was a baby-faced priest who really enjoyed, I think that was my kind of first, probably first meeting of some of the young people of the community. And obviously since then, I've been involved in a number of your outreaches and mission and all that sort of stuff. So I think I come as a friend, as a brother, fellow traveller on a pretty similar kind of road. And that also means that the kind of questions that you guys talk about and think about are the kind of questions that we talk about down south as well. So that hopefully, that's kind of the perspective I come with, if you like. The final thing I want to say as an intro was just, there's a good chance that a lot of what I say tonight, at least some of what I say tonight, you'll have heard before. Repetition's not a bad thing, especially sometimes you need to be reminded of something if it's important, things that we can forget. But also there's a chance that that I'll say something that I think's obvious and other people won't think it's obvious at all. So forgive me if you kind of feel like I'm saying something that you've heard. Okay, so a little bit of a roadmap of where we're going. Charismatic renewal, we're going to talk about baptism in the Spirit, and we're going to talk about communities. And the plan is to have some oranges at half time. So about halfway through we'll stop and just have a little break and then we'll push on. Hopefully I won't keep you too long. That's what Henry VIII said to his wives. Hopefully I won't keep you too long. Just call me dad. All right, so charismatic renewal. You know that line from Shakespeare, what's in a name? A rose by any other name and still smell as sweet. So Shakespeare got that profoundly wrong, right? Names really matter. And in the scriptures, that's particularly true. We've already talked about Saul becoming Paul, Sarai becoming Sarah, Abram becoming Abraham, Simon becoming Peter. Your name is really important. And so in the English-speaking world, the thing that we've been caught up in is called the charismatic renewal. It wasn't always called that. To begin with, they were called Catholic Pentecostals. And for fairly obvious reasons, that was decided to be kind of unfortunate and needed to be changed. There's a loss in that in some way, but you can understand why they changed it as well. The problem with calling what we've been part of the charismatic renewal is it makes it about the charisms. Yeah? So the problem with if we just call what we've been caught up in the charismatic renewal, then it's all about the charisms. And so let me just quickly define charism as I understand it. I think this is kind of normal Catholic theology. They're gifts from God for the building up of the church for the sake of the world, okay? Really important, we'll come back to them. But it's not just about the charisms. So the story that gets told, if you start focusing on the fact that this is the charismatic renewal, the story would go something like this. That once upon a time in the early church, there were lots of charismatic gifts going around. Everybody showed up, people prayed in tongues, they stepped out in miracles, they healed people in Jesus' name, they prophesied. But then over time, those charisms, for a bunch of reasons, dried up. They got quenched and they were all but lost to the church. And then the story would go that then in 1967, they were given back to the Catholic Church when a group of students at Duquesne University gathered for a weekend where they'd been reading Acts of the Apostles and they'd prayed for the gift of the Spirit. And then, so the idea is then at that point in time, what the church received were these gifts back for the church, and particularly tongues and prophecy and healing. Now that story isn't entirely wrong, but it's really problematic. There's much more to what happened that weekend, and there's much more to what we might call being charismatic than just that. What it sounds like it is that what we're about, what we're focused on, is about the gifts being given back to the church. Now, the next step in that story is that we tend to focus upon what's distinctive. In the church, because we're this sort of big kind of wide range of different things in the church, And there's a lot that we have in common. Eucharist is central to everybody in the church. Scriptures are central, you know, and so what we tend to do is we tend to focus on the things that make us distinctive. And so as the charismatics emerged in the life of the church, people focused on what was distinctive. And of course, one of the most obvious things about that was the way that they gathered and prayed. Okay, so we gathered for prayer, we prayed in tongues, we looked for prophecy, we prayed for healing. So what seemed to be new and distinctive about the early charismatics was that this is what they did. The next step in that story was that people wanted to gather together to be able to pray in that way. And so very quickly, I think, in the mind of the broader church, not in the church's theology, and not necessarily particularly at the level of the bishops and certainly the Pope, but popularly, people started to see, I think, the charismatic renewal fundamentally as a movement of prayer. And so there's no accident that, you know, there was the charismatic prayer group was kind of the basic kind of unit of the early charismatic renewal. From there, it's a really quick step to defining being charismatic as a spirituality, which is largely characterized by what we would call today praise and worship, and has that focus around things like praying in tongues and prophesying. And perhaps in the early days too, there was more of a focus on healing, whether that kind of has had the same kind of emphasis in recent years. I'm hoping you can see the problem with this. I'm hoping as you're sitting there hearing that, you're going, yeah, but that's not what we're about. There's more to it than that. See, the issue is that when you define charismatic renewal in that way, it becomes an optional spirituality. Just like someone can say, well, I'm kind of Benedictine in my spirituality, or I'm Ignatian in mine, or I'm Franciscan in mine. Oh, and yeah, I'm charismatic in mine. Now, what that has had the effect of doing is it can sideline what we're really about. Okay? Like to, good to hear the nods. And you know you're in a charismatic gathering when people nod and yeah, I get a little bit of a brother and amen. Thank you very much. Good on you. Now, I think we've got to, and part of that was the wider church was largely responsible for that. But in the renewal, people didn't necessarily help that. Because I think as that started to happen, what we started to do much more loudly was say, no, this is great that you need to be able to pray in tongues, and we should be praying for healing, and we need to believe in miracles. Yeah? So when you get threatened, you insist upon the things that are important. And so we kind of could have contributed to that. So we prayed louder in tongues, and we kind of, you know, laid more hands on people and all that sort of stuff. So being called the charismatic renewals caused us some problems, because the story wasn't a full enough story, a rich enough telling of the story. It didn't really do justice to what had been unleashed upon the church with that weekend, at that weekend of university students back in 1967. Interestingly, the Italians never called what we call the charismatic renewal the charismatic renewal. You probably know this. They call it the renewal in the spirit. That's significant, isn't it? I want to suggest that's a much better name. Okay? So they called it the renewal in the spirit, and they still do. Why is that helpful? Because what does the Holy Spirit renew? Everything. Everything. The Holy Spirit renews everything. The entire Christian life. And so that's why at the very heart of what we call the charismatic renewal, what the Italians call the renewal in the spirit, the very heart of that is what we call the baptism in the spirit. Okay? Now, it's because the spirit renews everything that the heart of the renewal is not the charisms. They are important, and I'm going to come to them. The heart of the renewal is baptism in the spirit. Now, to say that the Holy Spirit renews everything, in particular, is to say that the Holy Spirit renews baptism within us, because baptism is the foundation of everything in the Christian life. So that means for just a moment, I want us to think a bit about baptism. Different ways of expressing baptism, different kind of theologies of baptism, which is another way of saying there are different stories at work of baptism. The one that I've found so helpful is to say that baptism is the beginning of our deification. Baptism is the beginning of our deification. Now, what's deification? The amens in the room suggest to me that you know a little bit about that. Here's Athanasius' definition from the 4th century. God became one of us so that we might become God. God became one of us so that we might become God. It's an extraordinary statement, isn't it? Extraordinary. So the Son of God became a human being like us in Jesus in order that we might share in the divine life that the Son enjoys with the Father in the Spirit. That's why. And part of how I would describe that is to say, well, we need to think about what's the divine life of God? The word that often gets used is that it's a Greek word, ekstasis. It's the word we get ecstasy from. That the life of the triune God, the life of the Trinity, is a constant going out. Each person of the Trinity goes out to the other in an ecstatic gift of love. And we, by virtue of our baptism, are caught up in that. We are drawn into the very life of ceaseless giving of love between the persons of the Trinity. My best slide was this little, was I got the guy from Guardians of the Galaxy going, right? That was my best slide. The whole purpose of the slideshow was to get to that, really. But you know why, right? You know why. Like we, you know, I mean, just talking about that takes my breath away. But it also names something of our experience, right? That we are invited into that. So the word for that is theosis. The word for deification in Greek is theosis. So you have the ecstasis of God, which is shared with us through God becoming one of us. The self-emptying of Jesus, the Son of God taking on our humanity so that we might be raised to the life that Jesus has with the Father. One of the images in Scripture, of course, is the image of adoption, that Jesus is the Son by nature and we are the sons and daughters of God by adoption, by grace. Just as a little theological underline there, that preserves the fact that we actually aren't God. So when it says that we become God by grace. We share in the divine life of God, but God is God and we're human beings. But we do share in the very life of God by grace. And unlike where the analogy of adoption falls down, of course, is that that's a legal description. Okay, there's a legal definition. If I adopt somebody, there's a legal decision that says that person becomes my son or my daughter. God, in and through his Son Jesus, makes us his sons and daughters. The only begotten Son, Jesus, shares with us his relationship with the Father. So we're sons and daughters like him, but by grace rather than by nature. So how do we enter into this? It's by being joined to Jesus, and particularly by being joined to his death and resurrection. Just a couple of passages from Scripture. Romans 6, verse 3 to 4. Are you unaware that we who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried with him through baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live in newness of life. You trust the babies to be voted. From Colossians 3, verse 3. For you have died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. What's Paul saying there? It's about baptism. He's not talking to people who are dead. He's talking to people who have died in baptism. So baptism unites us to Jesus' death and resurrection. And it's through that we are given the Spirit. In Romans, again, if the Spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, the one who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit that dwells in you. Now, life there is not human life. It's not the life of creation. It's the life of God. It's the life of God. So the life we're given is that life, that ecstatic life of communion with God. Now the problem, of course, is that we don't live our baptism. The problem is that, and the image I'm drawing on Father Raniero Cantalamessa here, who's drawing upon Thomas Aquinas, when he says, often our baptism is not released in us. And so there's a principle in Catholic theology that says that our sacrament can be tied. So if somebody is married while they're in a state of mortal sin, or if they're ordained while they're in a state of mortal sin, they've received the sacrament, but the sacrament's effects aren't able to work because it's been blocked. Similar principle going on here with baptism. I've been baptized, but it hasn't been released in my life. I am not experiencing the effects, the grace in my life. Why? In this case with baptism, it's because often we were baptized as infants, and the adult faith, the adult yes, the decision that I make for myself, not that somebody has made on my behalf, but my decision is required. And also my repentance. Think about Acts 2 when Peter preaches, first time we hear the kerygma, the proclamation of the gospel. And when those who are listening are cut to the heart, they say, what must we do to be saved? He says, you must repent and believe in the Lord Jesus and be baptized. Yeah? Okay. So baptism in the Spirit is actually that releasing of the gift of the Spirit that was given to us at our baptism but has often been tied. It hasn't been released because we haven't come with faith and repentance. And to think back to the Duquesne weekend for a moment, we sometimes kind of can get the picture of that weekend that they all kind of, remember there was supposed to be a party that night. No one was that interested in the party and they all found their way to the chapel and then they had this profound experience of the Spirit being poured out upon them. True enough as far as it goes, but it's not the whole story. They'd spent the weekend reading the Acts of the Apostles. They'd been reading the cross and the switchblade. They'd been saying, we really want to receive what those first Christians received. Paddy Galligan Ansfield famously writes up on the board, the notice board, I want a new Pentecost. Stuck it on the board. So they prepared for it. Yes, it was the sovereign grace and action of God, but they were doing what I've been saying here. They are coming with faith and repentance, seeking the gift of the Spirit. So that's what baptism, that's at the heart of what baptism in the Spirit is. Now, our deification begins in baptism, but we also become deified through a life of conversion. So what does the indwelling presence of the Spirit look like in our lives? Well, I want to underline again, it's an intimate knowledge of God. And so it's often the beginning of deep prayer. So there's a contemplative dimension to being baptized in the Spirit, to being charismatic, if you like. The Eucharist and the Scriptures come alive. There's a moral change. We experience freedom from sin and a new capacity to love. We begin to seek ways of being led by the Spirit in our lives, learning to discern the ways of God. We also experience a new vocation, whether that's being given to us or whether our existing vocation is being renewed. But we experience that. A passion for evangelization, a heart for the poor, a heart for addressing injustice, a love of the church, and a desire for real community. Not just a theoretical abstract concept, but people living a life of faith together. That could be probably relevant to you guys, I don't know. And I want to come now to the charisms and say that the charisms are also released in us because the charisms are given to us at our baptism. The image I like to use is to say that I think for the church for a long time played a number of keys on the piano. They played the keys of the charism of teaching and preaching, if you like. They played the charism of pastoral care. They played the charism of leadership. But they were all held in the priest. And the other charisms bubbled up at various points in the life of the church, but they weren't very evident. Then the renewal comes along, and in the renewal we started playing another set of keys, and we particularly played the tongues and the prophecy and the healing keys of the piano. What God wanted us to do is to use the whole of the keyboard, all of the charisms. sometimes you hear the distinction of extraordinary and ordinary charisms. I find that really problematic kind of language. Every charism is extraordinary. They're all gifts of the Spirit of God. But in a funny sense, they're also all ordinary. Even the ones, I mean, I guess we're kind of used to the ones that other people find kind of like, oh, but they're ordinary. Like, you know, you probably have people who have had or have the gift of healing in your community. Father Don Coutts is somebody who has the gift of healing in ours. Don's the ordinariest bloke. When he prays over people and he prays this funny little prayer and people are healed. And for him, it's very ordinary, but extraordinary things do happen through it. I want to suggest that all of the charisms are extraordinary. They're all ordinary and we need all of them. And the image that I found very helpful is that when a community is exercising all of the charisms that have been given to it, it's like a matrix of conversion. I find that a really suggestive image, that when people are exercising the charisms that they've been given, a matrix of conversion is created. It's a place where God's tangibly real. It's a place where God seems absolutely present and alive with his love. This makes sense of something like Ignite, that when you get together and you put on something like that and all of these people are using their different gifts, from the administrators to the preachers and teachers to the worship to the people on the sound desk, everyone's using their gifts, something is created in that space that is far bigger than just the event that you're putting on. And I think that the image of a matrix of conversion is very suggestive of it. It's what God intended for his church. So that's a really important part, but we want to include it as part of all of these things that happen through the renewal of the Spirit. I want to say just one little word about tongues as well. Some people, you know, like obviously I love praying in tongues. You know, I can say with St. Paul, I'm so happy I pray in tongues. I don't expect all of you will, but I'm so happy that I do that sort of stuff. One of the things that I think has been most helpful for me to understand about tongues is that I think it serves, if it's a charism, of course, it's actually something for the church. The way that often gets interpreted then is we say, well, there needs to be an interpretation. That's one called sort of explanation, trying to find a way of saying, well, isn't tongues just your kind of prayer relationship with God? Now, there's something in both of those things. The thing I found most helpful to understand tongues is to say that I think it's actually supposed to say to the church that Pentecost still happens. That Pentecost is now. Yeah? That it's still going on in the life of the church. That to me just puts a whole other picture on what happens when we praise God in that way. What we're saying to the world is the Holy Spirit still falls upon people. The Holy Spirit is still poured out upon all flesh. Okay? So that's my little take on tongues. Two final things to say before the halftime orange break. I want to just say that the Holy Spirit addresses the little Pelagius that's running around inside of us. Yeah? Pelagius, of course, was the monk who had a big fight with Augustine, basically saying, look, I know you're into this grace kind of thing, but we've got to take a step towards God. That was Pelagius' thing. We've got to do it. We've got to take a step towards God. God will meet us, but we take the step. And of course, Augustine's big thing was to say, no, it's all grace. Even the step that you take, and you do have to take a step. You have to make a step of faith. You do need to repent. But even that is grace. So part of what we're caught up in is reminding us and reminding the church that we're not Pelagius. Okay, there's a reason why we call that a heresy. Profound distortion of the gospel. I want to suggest to you that Pelagius wasn't just a monk living in the 5th century. There's a little Pelagius running around in you and me. And so I want to give you a new name tonight, because we're into names at the moment. The new name is Pneumatophorus. Pneumatophorus, do you like that? I'd like you to think about my name for a second. Do you understand what that means? Christopher means Christ bearer, right? Pneumatophorus is Greek for spirit bearer. Yeah? We're spirit bearers, not Pelagius. Okay. Now, the last thing I want to say is that if this talk had been said for much of the last 50 years, certainly probably the first 10 years of the renewal, we probably would have stopped there. But I think there's something really important that we've learnt along the way. Remember how I said that we have the ecstasis, the ecstasy of God, and God, the triune God's purpose was theosis, to deify us, to draw us into that divine life. The path that God took to effect that was kenosis, the self-emptying gift of Jesus. That the Son of God became one of us. He emptied himself of his divinity to assume our humanity and was humble yet, St. Paul says, to even go into the cross. What we've learnt, I think, along the way is that you can't get theosis, no one gets deified, without walking the path that Jesus walked, without walking the path of self-emptying love. So I hope we've learned something along the way about humble, suffering, love of others being the path to deification. In other words, there's no triumphant story of glory here without the cross of Jesus and our sharing in the cross of Jesus. In the words of St. Paul, to finish this moment, 2 Corinthians 4:10, we carry in our bodies the death of Jesus so that the life of Jesus, the deified life of Jesus, the theotic life of Jesus, the ecstatic life of Jesus, may be made present in our bodies. I'm going to show you the slide that I... Look at that. That's pretty cool, right? That's what deification does, right? Okay. Look, see, pretty diagrams and everything. All right. Okay. So, let's push on. Communities. What kind of community is Emmanuel? I'm not going to tell you who you are. I'm going to just try and say something about the bigger context that I think communities like Emmanuel, that the movement of God that a community like Emmanuel is caught up in. It's obviously the same grace that the community that I'm part of, the Disciples of Jesus, is caught up in as well. I wanted to start with, the last time I was in Brisbane, I was here with some of you for a day with Father James Mallon. And those of you who are here will remember that one of the people sitting at my table, Selena Hashem, who would be known to many of you, asked him a question where she said, as he's presenting his vision for the renewal of parish, and I know that divine renovation is something that you guys are looking at, and I'm very excited about what divine renovation promises to the church, I think it captures much of what we're about in many ways. However, when Selena put up her hand, she said, what do you think about the role of the movements in this kind of thing? Those of you there perhaps will remember this quite clearly. James Mallon said, I think I'm pretty sure I'm quoting him accurately. I'm going to quote him accurately. The slide is simpler. It's going to be a distortion. That's risky, but here we go. I'm pretty sure he said, with the exception of the new movements that have given rise to new spiritualities or specific missions to the poor, new movements exist because parishes have failed. Anyone want to, is that how you recall it, pretty much? Yeah? I've thought about that a lot for obvious reasons, right? And so what I wanted to share with you is my kind of response to that, okay? I'm technically a parish priest again now. I love parishes. I think the renewal of parish is absolutely the very heart of what God would want to be doing at this time. But that doesn't have to be at the expense of a new movement or community like us, or like you. It could easily seem like it was true though, this bit. There's a way of telling the story of the birth of communities like ours, yours and mine, where we got baptized in the Spirit and we came back to our parishes and said, the most amazing things just happened to me. And the parish priest and the parish council and a whole bunch of other people looked at us like we had two heads and said, you guys are crazy, and didn't know quite how to handle us. For some of you, that will have been a very real experience, I dare say, okay? So it was kind of natural that you'd then go, okay, well, let's form a place where we can be who we are supposed to be in the church, where we can express ourselves as we believe God's been working with us. We couldn't pray like we wanted to, so we formed our own community. Now, if that's so, we've got a problem, because part of what's happened, I think, is that parishes are actually starting to get their act together. Now, there might be a long way to go, and I'll be the first to say there's absolutely a long way to go. But people are talking, like, I remember getting up as a little pre-novice in Canberra, 1994, and saying, I understood that the mission I was called to was evangelization at a diocesan assembly. And all of these people looking at me like I had two heads, right? Well, nobody's looking at anyone talking about evangelization in the broader church like they've got two heads anymore. The church has moved, right? And thanks be to God for that, right? But that could look like that's kind of squeezing out why we're here. So here's some thoughts about how I understand this. I'm going to confess to you at this point that none of of what I'm about to say is mine. I pinched it all from a guy called Joseph Ratzinger. You've probably heard of him. So before he was Pope, Joseph Ratzinger gave a talk, and the talk's been published, a really important paper, I think, on new movements. One of the things he says at the beginning of the paper is, he says, we need to be careful about saying new movements are charismatic and the church is institution. Okay, he doesn't want you to do that. He said, one of the ways he says that is, he says, look, in that model, the priest is very much a figure of the institution. He says, no, priests have to be charismatic. So we shouldn't be pitting charism and institution that way. He also says we shouldn't think about new movements in terms of the prophetic kind of word to the hierarchy. Now, that's interesting, because I reckon that's one of the ways we probably have thought about ourselves at one time or another, that we're supposed to be a prophetic voice that calls the church to something. Now, Ratzinger's not going to deny that, but he wants to be very careful about that, I think, because I think what he's saying there is that's really open to issues, okay? So there will be a prophetic dimension to what comes next, but he's saying that don't conceive of it like that. For him, the critical category is that a community like yours, a community like mine, is apostolic. And he wants to explain what that means. He goes back to the scriptures, as he will always do. So classic Ratzinger sets up a problem. Where do we go first? He goes to the scriptures. And he goes to Acts 1:8, which I quoted a lot at one stage in my priestly career. You will be my witnesses to the ends of the earth. Yeah? You will be my witnesses to the ends of the earth. He says, if you want to understand apostolic, that's what the early apostles understood themselves to be doing. They were to go to the ends of the earth. He also quotes Matthew 28:19. Go make disciples of all nations. Okay? So the part of being an apostle was to go to the whole world in order to proclaim the gospel and to build up the one body of Christ. And so he says that in the beginning, the 12 were never bishops of, like what we now would call a bishop, they were never the leader of a local place. Okay? They were never the leader of a community in a local area. None of the 12 have that. So I'll give you an example, a figure like Thomas, I live with Indians who would make a strong case for Thomas going to India. But they don't say he went here, they say he went here, 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 and here. Because he went to the ends of the earth as he experienced that at that time. So none of the 12 were ever the local leader of a community. You can see very clearly in Paul too. Paul understands himself to be an apostle, but he never sets himself up as a leader of a community that he's founded. Think about all the communities that he begins. Never does he set himself up as the leader of it, but he absolutely understands himself as an apostle. So what happens in the life of the church is that two meanings to the word apostle start to emerge. One of them becomes local church leadership, part of the structure that we now know as bishop, priest, and deacon. So the apostle, the successor of the apostles, are the bishops. Now the other one, though, we might call a missionary office, not bound by location, but fulfills that sense of being an apostle that goes to the ends of the earth. And you can see these two meanings still in the scriptures. Okay, what's often called the Catholic epistles has the beginnings of the first one. And we've already been describing this second one and how you see it in a figure like Paul. So now, to make the point, think about even today, bishops who are auxiliary bishops, okay? They're given a title, aren't they? They're given what's called a titular see. So an auxiliary bishop here in Brisbane, I don't know, it's usually somewhere in Africa that used to be a diocese and there's no longer a Christian community there. The sense of being a bishop is connected to a particular place. What Ratzinger says now, though, is that could never exhaust the meaning of being an apostle. We needed also that sense of apostle that went, we're going to go to the ends of the earth and proclaim the gospel. And so he actually says there are two meanings of apostolic succession that we need to take seriously. This is Pope Benedict XVI. I find this fascinating. First one, he says, is the sense of apostolic succession that we know about, which is that sense of guaranteeing the one faith. Okay, the successors of the apostles. Apostolic succession is to say we believe in unity, in continuity with what has gone before, and in communion with the other dioceses around the world. But we still need another kind of apostolic succession, which is we need people who are going to take the gospel to the ends of the earth. And here Ratzinger says, well, the key person, the only bishop who has a universal mission, is the Pope. Because before he got the job. The person who has a universal mission is the Pope. But he says it would be a terrible thing. He actually says it would be a monstrosity. Direct quote. It would be a monstrosity if we actually confined that sense of apostolic mission just to the Pope. Too much of a burden for one man, right? And a distortion of what it would mean for him to be universal. Some trends in the church absolutely want that for the Pope. Other trends in the church, rightly, Ratzinger says, recognize that's too much to ask of the one office. And so the solution, God's solution, not Ratzinger's and not even the church's, the solution is that in the life of the church, apostolic movements emerge that fulfill this role. And so you have, this is not an exhaustive list, it's just the ones that Ratzinger mentions, the monastic movement, okay? Then the mendicant movement, that's Francis and Dominic, the Jesuits with Ignatius. In the 19th century, you have this huge emergence of religious orders, many of whom are women, and Ratzinger particularly says that they often had a particular focus for the poor. Makes particular reference to that. He says, look, it's not to say that these earlier ones weren't caring for the poor, but there was something particular about women in these apostolic movements that did that, that emerged in the 19th century. Sisters of Charity, the Daughters of Charity, the Mercies, and so on. And then down to today, and that's us. The distinctive thing, each of these have distinctive features, but they have much more in common than distinctive. What's distinctive about our time? Apart from myself and Nev, you are all lay people. Right, so each of these movements started out as lay movements. Yeah? Each of these movements started out as lay movements. So, what are the characteristics of these movements? They're not confined to a geographic location. They've got that impetus to take the gospel to the ends of the earth. They live the vita evangelica, the apostolic life, or the gospel life. They live it radically. Think about the monastic movement. They want to live the gospel radically. Think about Francis, the best example of it. If you'd said to Francis of Assisi, what are you doing? He said, I'm just living the gospel. He didn't say, I'm starting up an order. He wouldn't have said, I'm doing this whole new mission. He would just say, I'm doing what Jesus asked us to do. Living the gospel radically. A call, obviously, to evangelize, that they're to take that mission, to proclaim the gospel wherever, and not to be bound by a geographic location. And because of the link between the Pope, who has the same mission, Pope has the same mission as these apostolic movements, these movements have had the support of the papacy in very special ways. And again, Francis is perhaps the paradigm example. Remember this little two-bit outfit. He goes up, this little poor man, goes to see the Pope, height of the medieval world and says, here I am. And of course the Pope's had this dream about him and says, I give approval to your rule. Extraordinary kind of moment. But for Ratzinger, that's almost the paradigm example of this, that because the Pope and the new movements are apostolic, they have the same apostolic mission, the Pope particularly supports them. Which is why I think it's really interesting for us that Paul VI, as the emergence of the renewal took place, Paul VI very quickly became the great champion of the renewal. Really interesting, huh? And significant. Also, as I mentioned, a particular focus on the love of the poor. The credibility of that gospel mission was also in the love of the poor. Here's the quote from Joseph Ratzinger regarding the papacy and the role of Peter. This is a huge quote. We could even say that the primacy of the successor of Peter, so the primacy of the papal office, is to guarantee the presence of these essential components of ecclesial life and bring them into an ordered relationship with the structures of the local church. So he's saying the purpose of the papacy, I need my little thing, right? To guarantee the presence of these essential components of ecclesial life and to make sure that they really work to actually bring about what they're supposed to do in the life of the church. And that is actually to renew the church. You can see each of these movements are renewal movements in their apostolicity. So, I need to finish. Ooh, I don't want to finish quite that quickly. couple of final thoughts about it, again, from Ratzinger. He says the key features, the leader, they normally emerge as the result of a leader with a vision. It's interesting for us in some ways, perhaps. They have a concrete form of association. They desire to live the gospel in a new way. And they take the church as the foundation of their life by which they can't exist. By which they must exist. They cannot but exist. He says the yardstick for them is their Catholicity, is that they say we're Catholic and they understand themselves to be part of the church. But also their yardstick is that they are living their criteria. And this is a good little communal examination of conscience for us. Are they living an apostolic life? Are they living a life of radical gospel living? Are they living a life of radical evangelization to the ends of the earth? Are they practically loving the poor? He acknowledges the dangers of the apostolic movements, the risks involved. And what he says particularly is, he says, and this is, I think, so important for us in communities, he says the key thing they can do is they can overemphasize what they've been given. They can overemphasize what they've been given. It's very sensible, very, very important. He also says that it could also work the other way too, of course. Part of what he's doing is he wants to say to the bishops of the church, your role is to actually help to order these apostolic movements within the life of the local church. He says we should be careful of a false communion. He says if there's no conflict, that's actually problematic. He points to that being a false communion. And he also warns the bishops against an over-programming that leaves no room for the Spirit. At the same time, he says that apostolic movements need to be careful of a lack of humility and that they need to be obedient to their local bishop. For him, the ultimate sign is that they're actually committed to the true unity of the church. And so, Ratzinger concludes, as I will, with gratitude and joy. Gratitude that we've been caught up in this incredible mystery, this wonderful gift of grace, with all of its challenges and problems. And, you know, I've been living the community thing for a while now too, but I know what that's like. But there's something extraordinary that's been given to you. But I think that this is the most helpful way of understanding what new communities are in the life of the church.